So we are going live right now.
Hello and welcome. I appreciate your being a part of this. I appreciate you being a part of this session. We are trying to figure out how to make this a little bit interactive since I cannot see any of you. And so I want to just express my appreciation for Megan to, she's going to be bringing some of your questions into the chat. I will just go ahead and start the screen share. And then if you would like to maybe type in your questions as we go so that I can take it from there. And if, okay. So there I'm registering today, you could see that. Okay. So I wanted to start where we left off in part and to think about how we move from theory into action or into praxis. So I build here on the work of bell hooks that this space of radical openness is a margin, she says, a profound edge. Locating oneself there is necessary. And she does say that it's difficult. It is not a safe place. One is always at risk. One needs a community of resistance. And when we're thinking about this recovery of these, of the stories that I talked about from the other session, that they really, as Margaret Montoya talks about us, are supposed to be tools that help inform our praxis. So storytelling and other critical tools, she says, must refashion our curricula and our pedagogies. I am not sure if this is going to play, but I wanted to remind us that our histories are contested. And I feel like this goes very much with what the our poet just shared with us. So let me see if this will play. And if it will not, then I will try something else. It seems to be frozen here. It is frozen. So let me exit. Let me see if it'll play like this. It will play like this. So let me try it one more time.
Tearing everything down. Tearing down our heritage. Tearing down the memory of people who fought and died for this land.
We fought and died for this land too. We fought the U.S. Army, the Texas Rangers.
Yeah, you lost, buddy.
Yeah.
Winners get the bragging rights. That's just the way it goes.
People. I think it would be best if we don't view this thing in terms of winners and losers.
Well, the way she's teaching, it's got everything switched around. I was on the textbook committee, and her version is not...
We think of the textbook as a guide, not as an absolute.
It is not what we set as the standard. Now, you people can believe whatever you want, but when it comes to teaching our children...
There are children, too, and as a majority in this community, we have the right.
Oh, yeah, well, the men that founded this state have the right. The right to have their story told the way it happened, not the way somebody wanted it.
The men who founded this state wrote from Mexico because they needed slavery to be legal to make a fortune in the cotton business.
I think that's a bit of an oversimplification.
Are you reporting this meeting, Danny? Are you running it?
Just adding a little historical perspective.
Well, yeah, but you call it history, I call it propaganda. Now, I'm sure they got their own account of the Alamo on the other side, but we're not on the other side.
Excuse me. I've only been trying to get across part of the complexity of our situation down here. Cultures coming together in both negative and positive ways.
If you're talking about food and music and all, I have no problem with that. But when you start changing who did what to who...
We're not changing anything. We're just trying to present a more complete picture.
And that's what's got to stop.
Look, there's enough ignorance in the world without us encouraging it in the classroom.
Now, who are you calling ignorant?
Okay, for those of you who are not film buffs, this is a scene from Lone Star, and it is by, it is a a film that is put forward by John Sayles as an independent film from, I believe, 1997. This is one of the only images that I've found, and I study film and I have a whole area. I'm sharing this with you because part of what we're thinking about these tools and these stories and who gets to tell our stories and how do we center our stories, that it is very complicated. And that why I appreciate this, this is one of the only scenes where you actually see Latina, Latino parents in a classroom advocating for their children. And you see a Latina teacher, rest in peace, the actress who is playing this Latina teacher here, is having to defend her curriculum, but she also is sitting with allies, which is her principal and a co-teacher that she has here, and they are also helping to moderate this questioning that she is receiving from some of the parents who feel that there's this very tense scene that we have here. And this is a tool that I like to use because I like to use media that is available to students, but that offers an oppositional kind of framing, which it was intended to offer, and to have them kind of think about all of the complexities that went into this. So I use these mainstream films and I use some of the clips within them. I'm in the process of, if I speak it into existence, it will happen. I'm in the process of writing a book about from 1955 till about 2007, there were at least 10 films that have one identifiable or more Latina, Latino student. And I use that word as broadly defined because sometimes you have the film set in Florida, but they're using mariachi and they have a very difficult time kind of identifying who are these different characters. Some of the work of Carlos Cortez actually has a whole, he has a whole article, who is Juan and who is Maria and how do we identify them? But in a classroom in around a high school setting is where these students are. So I'm really looking at Latinas and Latinos in schools according to Hollywood. And in that analysis, I have this scene as part of it to help us understand the ideological timing of these messages that we receive, constant messages that we receive about who we are, who people next to us sitting in the classroom are, and how we might understand the construction of these images as also reflective of the ideas that folks have about race and racism, and how these ideas of cultural deficit thinking in particular are perpetuated through films. So I also use them as examples when I'm working with teachers to, let me see if this will forward now, to offer different pedagogical strategies of what critical pedagogy looks like and can look like on film. And this example is taken from Walkout. And Walkout was not released in theaters, but it was released on HBO. And then HBO offered a free weekend. It's from 2006. This is produced by Moctezuma Esparza and directed by Edward James Olmos. I usually would take a raise of hands if folks have seen this film, but I can't see you, so I don't know. So if you have not seen this, it's available sometimes on HBO, but you can get it, probably order it, the DVD. And I recommend this film also for classroom use, as it is one of the only, it is the only dramatized version that we have. There is a documentary version. This comes in a four-part Chicano civil rights movement series of taking, it's called Taking Back the Schools, that part of it. But this is the only dramatized version of the 1968 walkouts that were led by high school students. And of course, we do not expect a film to offer all of the complexities of a historical moment, but I think that it does quite a good job of talking about many of the complexities of it. And I've analyzed it in some of my articles. The Lone Star piece gives an example of John Sayles is actually a white filmmaker. Can white people tell counter stories? Yes, I hope they can, and they do tell counter stories. But the thing is who is taking center stage? Whose stories take center stage? In the Lone Star example, that film is actually about Native American, Mexican American, African American, and Anglo-American folks all living in the Lone Star State. And it's puts the audience in this perspective of the mystery and the complexities of history as you're kind of a detective along trying to uncover parts of this story, which is, so they're going back in time and forward in time. In this film and Walk Out, they are telling a story that takes place over a series of months. And it is talking about some of the organizing that was involved, some of the consciousness raising that was involved in some of the walkouts, and what led some of these students, what were the conditions that led these students to organize five different high schools and eventually 10,000 students all across Los Angeles, and then it went to other states to walk out of their high schools in protest of wanting a more equal education. And you see it portrayed in this film through the experiences specifically of this young Chicana here. She is Mexican American and Filipina, and so she is coming to her own identity within this. And this is based on an actual person, and so that you can also use this in relation to with the documentary and talk through with the different texts that are out there. And so I offer this also as an example of whose voices end up taking center stage. Most of the other films in the genre of talking about urban schools really center the teacher. And in this film, there's very few scenes where the teacher is centered. His Sal Castro, but I'm gonna show you the one scene that opens the film, where he is at the center. If I can play.
Bobby.
Yes,
Gettysburg.
I don't know, homeless people that killed.
Come on, scratch a little deeper, Bobby.
Who fought there?
Americans.
Americans, how about your ancestors?
Mexicanos?
Yeah, Yoli, help them out. Read the part in the Chicano regiments.
Chicanos?
Or Mexican Americans. It was before we moved to East LA and became Vatos Locos.
Any luck, Kelly?
Read a part about Mariano Vallejo and his meeting with Abraham Lincoln. That's it.
Paula, help her out. Read the part of 9,000 Mexican Americans who fought in the American Civil War.
Mr. Castro doesn't say anything about Mexican Americans.
Let's see.
See, that's funny. We were there.
What side did we fight on?
Oh. Ooh, and we still lost?
Still lost. You know where we lost? We lost our legacy.
Why?
We're not in this book. See, if people don't know about it, then it never happened.
See, you're learning your history from people that don't know your history. Your blood is in Gettysburg.
How about Vietnam?
Your blood is in Vietnam too.
So I shared this scene also thinking about how he is asking them to engage in history, how he is asking them to think about He's not necessarily lecturing at them. And this is one of the questions that was posed in terms of examples of curriculum. So yes, I use media, but I am also, I'm using media similarly to how he's using a textbook to ask students to think critically. So in this scene, Sal Castro, rest in peace, is asking the students to think about why they're not in that book and to think about themselves as producers of knowledge, because if they're not in that book, he's asking them, how might we make sure that our history gets written and that they would be a part of writing that history. So having them think about that there is history beyond the book is all those are very important tools that I try to impart to my children, because that as you know, there is a whole very rigid set of the ways in which schools are supposed to work, that students are punished if they do not follow in that rigid set of what is in the book and don't go outside the book. And I have my 8-year-old constantly upset with me because that's not what the teacher said and I'm going to get in trouble. And it's a very fear-based approach. So he's actually shifting that to ask them specifically to look at what is not in the book. There's also a scene in the film where they are outside and they're at a camp. And so you can see that education also takes place outside of the classroom. He explains, until we get educated, somebody else will be writing our history. I want us to write it. I want us to make our own history. And in this case, he was sharing about an article that had been written about Chicanos in a popular magazine and how disturbingly distorted it was about who they are. So thinking about how they might make their own history and how that would get written. Again, that same theme running through. And when the film portrays this sharing of knowledge, this resistant capital that they are demonstrating, the navigational capital, there are these goals that they have as students. They go through, they exhaust all of the means of organizing and asking for change at their schools. They conduct a survey of all 5 high schools. They go to the board meetings. They follow all of the lines of authority. And eventually they decide they need to engage in civil disobedience. And this is when they walk out of schools. And they are also garner the support of their parents. Sal Castro and others end up being arrested and they argue for their release as well. So in the middle of this, you have here the student who is Paula Cristosomo, or portraying her. And the principal comes up to her, I don't see what you have to complain about. You've done extremely well here, individualizing the problem. And Paula, because she has now gone through this experience of seeing herself as having been purposefully omitted from history, seeing herself as possibly being able to contribute to history, sees herself connected. Immediately you see in that scene where just saying that we were in the Civil War and we fought on both sides and it was complicated and that is not being written about. There's a student that says, well, what about Vietnam? The ability to see themselves as connected across time and place. And Paula then takes that forward, that concept that she is not just fighting for herself in this struggle for educational opportunity, because it's not just me who is in this situation. So as we're another tool that I use is mapping, and that I really would encourage. A community asset is anything that makes your neighborhood a better place to live. And so there are different ways in which at different levels of the educational pipeline. And certainly we've already seen at Bunker Hill, that there are multiple places and spaces, and I know that there are initiatives on campus that really do purposefully connect students with their community. And so I would encourage the idea of bringing those into the classroom in more explicit ways. So this, taking these community assets and mapping them, we are very trained to we actually go around the neighborhood and find something wrong, you know, and identify blight. We have, this is the ways in which we are trained, especially young children. They'll actually, they will train us to look at one picture and what is missing from the other picture, right? That's actually a developmental skill that we learn. We learn less about how to map what is right, what makes our neighborhood a better place to live. So finding and making inventories of those assets and then taking those and bringing them into our classroom spaces. One of the ways in which I have seen this done very well is by Culture Clash. And I decided to share this version of my PowerPoint. I hope this is okay because I haven't gotten any feedback so far. So I have a different version that's more focused on higher education, but I wanted to share this with you, kind of carrying on in the spirit of the, and I was inspired by the poetry that we had this morning. So this Culture Clash is a group that started in 1984 in the Mission District of San Francisco. They actually performed around 2003 in Boston. I don't know if any of you have had a chance to see their show. In about 1994, they shifted their plays from doing more, they did about three plays before this, then after they started being commissioned to do plays about site-specific theater in similar to Anna Deavere Smith. So here you have Radio Mambo. Culture Clash Invades Miami was one of the first one that they were commissioned to do. And so they would go to the community. They did interviews with folks across all sections of the community. They looked at some of the history, the newspapers. They would usually identify from that a theme, and some of their work is verbatim quotes that they would come up with these characters. Others were kind of composite characters of the themes that they were finding, but they were really looking at these different concepts that the community had identified. So this, and they did so in ways to try to tell some of those stories of the community. So I appreciate their work in multiple ways. There's a one of them called New Eurekan Stories. These are all available now in books that have been published. If you'll be interested in sharing these with your students, some of them are available on iTunes, I believe it's called, but it's because it changes platforms. So the one that I will share with you in particular, it is available on iTunes. There is one that was called Border Town. And so these become the site-specific mapping of the voices that we rarely get to hear all across America. They did one in the Mission District. They did one in Washington, D.C. And in each place, what are you looking for? Your iPad? Sorry. It's not in here, Mijo. Zoom school is starting. In each place, they sometimes would do an additional one. When they did, they would do additional catering of the story to make sure that they were accounting for the different voices. Then they started taking each of these pieces, and they would do a little all across America in some of their performances from all of the places that they had done the individual plays. Chavez Ravine in particular then is represents another shift. So as they're mapping these counter stories all across America, these stories that are critical lived reflections, challenging of communities of color and that challenge this dominant ideology, Chavez Ravine tells the story of three neighborhoods, La Loma, Bishop, and Palo Verde, that were in the north, that were in the north part of downtown Los Angeles. There you go. There's the ones with that are the different pictures of the places where they would take all of them together, these different scenes. And these three communities were told in 1950s that their neighborhood was blighted and they needed to move out of Chavez Ravine, which is the actual ravine name, but their three neighborhoods, La Loma, Bishop, and Palo Verde, had been there since the early 1900s, late 1800s. And they were told in the 1950s that they needed to move because they were going to build public housing. The city wanted to build public housing. And what happened is that they were moved out for that public housing, but they were not allowed to move back in because the powers that be, the power brokers in downtown Los Angeles, including the Los Angeles Times and folks at City Hall and other actors, started saying that public housing at this time, there was the Red Scare 1950s, that public housing was something that was socialist. Of course, you hear that today about critical race theory. And this idea of socialism, without understanding the concept of actual socialism, but just using the word as a smear, they did away with public housing altogether. And so these communities were being permanently then displaced. The land is eventually gifted to the Dodger Corporation, and the Dodgers move in 1959 is when they destroy the last of the houses. And this was done live on national television. Then the Dodgers move in. And so there's a very complicated history of displacement that is echoes across experiences of gentrification and displacement that we see right now. We're having a national discussion about the horrors of what happened in Tulsa. And so you see that this is actually reverberations that happen all across time in different ways and places and spaces. And the erasure of those histories is an additional violence that is enacted on the communities. And so part of what we do in a piece, my colleague and I, David Garcia, in our piece, This Is No Slum, thinks about culture clash as recovering and reclaiming this history and really putting on display that the reason why these communities were displaced in the first place was because the power brokers did not recognize that space, which was predominantly Mexican, but also had immigrants from all over the world living in these different communities. There was a school there, there was a church there, there were playgrounds, there were many different ways in which they exuded community cultural wealth, but that was not recognized by the powers that be. And so what some of my co-author's work does really looks at how this is critical race theater. It illuminates the lives and histories of racially and socially marginalized communities, and it consciously challenges social and racial injustice. And so I'm going to just share with you that scene of how I'm playing the live removal, which they also did on stage, and they had that they're speaking over it. And this is one of the poets who lived in Chavez Ravine, Manzanar, who is speaking. And this is, before I play the clip, these are some of the other scenes. It's and this is what some of their intention was. So if you were to use this in either a history class, an English class, we could also use this in science classes when we're thinking about climate change and excuses for moving folks in and moving folks out, and what it looks like to have a community that has been taken over by freeways, and when we have this discussion of a new infrastructure bill and access to clean water and clean air, and how the excuses of environmental racism, that justification and that discourse, what the actual implications are for communities. So Herbert Sigüenza, one of the actors here who is portraying Fernando Valenzuela, who played it for the Dodgers, it's revisionist history. It's claiming that we are here. We are part of American history. And it's also reclaiming the other point of view. In Chavez Ravine, we take the point of view of the residents. They are the heroes, you know. We don't take the point of view of, let's say, the developer. We already know that issue. It's been written about. So we think about our political science classes, we might not necessarily think of having students writing a play or writing a series of monologues, but we might want to consider that as we really look at the interdisciplinary ways in which community cultural wealth can be utilized in our classrooms as a tool, and we can have them access that. Here's the scene.
1959, it was eviction time. And there on national television in black and white, 14 county sheriffs began forcibly removing the Las Familias from the hill.
We are not the Mulholland's. We are not the Lankershims or the Van Nuys, but you'll remember this name, Arechiga, Cabral, Casos, y Lopez, Perez, Ramirez. You took our sons to fight your war, and now you take our homes, our land. I don't want to be buried in Boyle Heights. I don't want to be buried in Whittier or White Fence. When I die, take my ashes and scatter them in La Loma, La Bishop, y Palo Verde. Mi casa no es tu casa. ¿Y sabes qué? Why don't you tell the pinche sheriff to build a stadium in his own goddamn backyard?
Memory cannot be flattened. Memory is history, singing in tune with the stars, and no sheriff's baton can reach that high.
So I wanted to share these few examples with you, and then leave this open for dialogue and reflection. As I opened up my talk in the other space, how might we take on Delgado's challenge that race is not merely a matter for abstract analysis, but for struggle? And for Galeano's assertion, how might we take on that in our work at Bunker Hill Community College, that our identity lies in that action in struggle? So thank you very much, and I look forward to your questions. I'm not sure about what OER is, the open resources. There is a question about if Culture Clash's resources are open education resources for use. I know that they have They have both. Some of their stuff is on just on audio. Some of the plays are just on audio. They are, if you download it, you can play it for your classes. And then I don't know. I know that they have at least three books of their plays. Any other questions? If you want me to keep talking, I'm always game for that too. So there's a mention of a corporate model which does not have an ethic. It predominates our culture. I think we need to address our overarching corporate model that dominates. I'm not sure if you mean because they're mainstream media messages. I'm not sure that I quite understand the question, but I do think that there is the community cultural wealth model does require an ethic. There is an ethic in the types of work that we do and how we approach our students and how we approach our work. And I think that one of the main issues that we do see in that corporate model is that individualistic. Someone would like for me to put the last slide back up, and I will do that. And I'm also going to, you know, as I do that, I'm going to, here we go. Did it share or no? Tell me if you could see it. Put a one if you can see it. If not, I might be only sharing it on my side. Okay, nope, that's good. Thank you. All right, here we go. Like the feedback. I have too many. There we go. Oh my. Okay. Phew. There we go. Okay. Thank you. So this is a this here is a mural by Luis Genaro Garcia. And it is called Metamorphosis. You see behind me also a butterfly and the concept of transformation. I know that one of the themes that you have is a transformational, transformative resistance. And so I wanted to share that with you and give him a shout out and appreciation for sharing his work with us. Are there other questions about, I know you wanted me to put this question back up. I'm seeing something now in the chat. It's just that I cannot, my thing froze, so I cannot see it. Let me see if I click, there it goes. Joy is asking about righteous anger as a motivating tool. Definitely. I use in my own work, I am very inspired by the work of Audre Lorde, who talks about our anger and talks about the anger, her anger and holding on to that anger and that anger of whether you should speak or when you should remain silent, and when you speak, she says we are not afraid, in that is that anger is libation for my fallen sisters. I do think that we need to hold on to our anger, but we also need to take care of ourselves. And I think that part of this righteous anger, it needs to move us forward. We cannot be immobilized forever by anger. I know that it feels, especially at this moment in time, completely debilitating. But I think that that is really thinking about ourselves, and we do need to take care of ourselves in order to move forward with that. So, but holding on to our anger and being driven by anger, that's gotten me through most of this. That's this righteous anger is what motivates us to, but we have to continue to move forward and use that anger as that tool. But I do also think that when we talk about the concept of anger, some may misunderstand. And I do think that as we're preparing students, for them to understand how people perceive our anger, and that it's not necessarily our job to make other people comfortable, but rather to prepare them for understanding the pushback that they will receive. For me, my anger often leads me to tears, and people will perceive that as, you know, overly emotional, or that they have somehow injured me. And I am like literally driven to tears and anger. It's a different, so just, but understanding what the perception is, other people will respond differently. But I also think that there is a lot of, we do a lot of holding in academia in general. I do think it's important for us to continue to hold on to the anger and have a civil discussion. I have seen a lot of women of color model this in different ways and share examples of how they do so in the middle of a faculty meeting, how they do so in a classroom, et cetera. I think that sharing that is important, both preparing students for how they will be perceived, telling them to just get over it is not the right way to do it, I would say. But I do think that letting them know that there will be pushback, and how they might navigate around that, and modeling some of that behavior, I think is really helpful for them. Right now, what I'm working on in my research is I have done a shift in looking at, I can share a little bit with you if there's something weird happening with my, I'm not sure if I can even stop the share. It literally has like paused my whole screen here. It won't let me. Okay, let me see. I'm going to end this show and then share. I'm going to look for it if I could find it for you. I am working on a piece that is recovering a history of Ernesto Galarza and his struggle with his daughter. No, I can't pull it up for you. Oh, here it comes. I'm going to stop sharing, then I'm going to find it. And then I'll, but I am looking at a piece of history that is in the archives that has not been considered before, because it was a case that did not get filed, a law case. And this is a case that happened in the 1947 pre-Brown v. Board of Education. And it is, an example for me of how complicated our histories are and how connected we are. So if I could pull it up, I'll find it. If I can't, then I won't. But basically, for those of you who may not know who Ernesto Galarza is, I encourage you to look up the novel Barrio Boy. And there are many other writings. That was after this experience of 1947. But I find his work fascinating for multiple reasons. One is that he enrolled his daughter in a, I can't find it, I'm sorry. He enrolled his daughter in a vocational school in Washington, D.C. In 1947, and it was an all, it was a segregated school, and she was learning to design dresses, and she was learning to make sure that, you know, there were not just dresses, but they were costume dresses. So she had the best teacher that she could find in, at this segregated school. And yet, here it is. Yay. There it goes. Okay. She was kicked out of the school 2 months after her enrollment. And so the, can you see it? I am having a technical difficulty and it won't let me, it pulled you up in front of my own screen. Okay, here we go. So this is the case. So they protested. Why did she get expelled from the school? She was expelled in, just like I said, it was a segregated co-educational Black vocational school. And her father, we were so excited when we found this, it is in the NAACP finding guide. So I recognize the name Galarza, and this tells you something, right? That your cultural intuition as Dolores Delgado Bernal and your access to these names is important, because then once you do that deep dive into the archives, you're uncovering histories. But had I not recognized that name, would I have known to look? But then once we found it, we found he's collaborating with his friend, Charles Hamilton Houston, who is the architect of the desegregation that we now know as Brown v. Board of Education. There were a series of cases that happened. And he, since the 1930s, was working with the NAACP. At this time, he was an independent lawyer working out of his office, Houston Hadley. And they also collaborated with ACLU, the American Jewish Congress, the National Lawyers Guild, and the NAACP. Ultimately, they did not file the case. So we covered over 100 pages over 10 months of work. And so you asked me what I'm working on. I'm working on trying to really think about how we have only a piece, a sliver of what the story is in this struggle for equal educational opportunity. Now, part of this story that we're talking about is the complexity of Carla being phenotypically white and the school board's declaration that for the purposes of school classification, she is a white person. Again, reminding you that she was not trying to pass for white, not trying to claim she was white. This is the Board of Education telling a student what her racial identity is and telling her she is not allowed to attend the Black school, which she thought was the most excellent educational opportunity. And that was what complicates this story. And one of the reasons why we might not have heard it until now. So Dr. Galarza explains he was one of the first Mexican origin students to earn a PhD at Columbia University. He also was prior to that, one of the first Mexican origin students to have earned a master's degree from Stanford University. He explained, and he was working at that time for the Pan American Union. This complicated story, we rarely hear of from a Mexican voice at this time period, challenging and engaging in this civil rights. We doubt that the Constitution gives Congress the legal right or moral authority to force lower educational opportunities to anyone on account of color. So they were protesting segregation as unconstitutional, but at the same time, they are recognizing a Black school as a site of excellence. So this narrative does not fit in the Brown v. Board of Education, in the whole architecture of how they are putting forward what it means to go to a segregated school. It makes that much more complicated. It was a Black principal, a Black teacher. The teacher herself had trained in Paris, had trained in New York, and was for Carla and Dr. Galarza, the ideal teacher. He explains, it is indeed a privilege for Carla to attend a course under a sympathetic, skilled, and generous teacher. Her name was Mrs. Wharton. But I could not take this statement of the board, meaning he's pushing back on them to mean that attendance in the course is a privilege, which the board may grant or withhold, rather than an opportunity, which the board should offer on terms of equality for all. So when I think about this story, and when I think about how I opened my earlier presentation with those pictures, I think about the ways in which we do need to bring back the humanity of our discussions about education and about educational policies and about who is protesting educational policies. These are really driven by a story of a father and a mother who are really pushing for the best for their children. And here this father is advocating on behalf of his daughters. Right here, they are actually in Peru. Carla, phenotypically white, spoke Spanish and English and was raised by her parents to be bilingual. She studied for a while in Peru and went where her father went. He was a labor organizer and activist and went on to help to end the main labor law in the United States that did not allow for agricultural workers to unionize. If you have no Dr. Galarza, you have no Cesar Chavez, you have no Dolores Huerta, because there were they had to end that labor law. That also ended the Bracero program. Our history is complicated, right? My father-in-law came to the United States as in the Bracero program, but they were not treated as guest workers who had the same rights. They were guest workers who were at a lower class who could not unionize and so could not question if someone was not following through with the contract, as they were doing labor all across the United States. This is also the complex story that we tell of that segregation is definitely was a horrific in multiple contexts. In the example that I shared of the humiliation that Antonia experienced, but there were also segregated schools, and this is Mrs. Wharton's classroom, that were beacons of excellence, of Black excellence from this teacher and to the students. And this was an example of pluralism that was happening in this classroom, that each of the students were able to recognize each other's dignity and were benefiting from that situation. And I'm not making those words up. Those are Dr. Galarza's words, 1947. Him, as he's questioning this, he's saying, here in Washington, D.C., if our goal was in education to realize pluralism, if our goal in World War II was to realize pluralism, to fight against tyranny, if we signed documents that are international agreements that we will not discriminate based on color or race, this is what we just fought for, how are we not doing that in our schools? So the complexities of this story, unfortunately, do not get captured by what happens did I end the share? Did it close? I cannot tell. So that these did not get captured in the end because that story did not get put forward in the court. So as we think about how to integrate these different ideas, for me, it's looking backward in order to move forward. And so examples of in the sciences, I definitely have seen examples of community cultural wealth in the sciences. So one of the lines that I'm bringing forward in terms of all of the different literatures are the funds of knowledge writings. And what those authors found, specifically when we're thinking about farm worker families, they were thinking about these families that may never come to the school, but have multiple forms of knowledge of the acidity of the soil, the lunar cycles, plants that are used as healing mechanisms. I think that there are multiple ways in, actually there are at least six NSF grants by scientists who are focused on STEM, who are using community cultural wealth, who have contacted me to be on their advisory board. So I know that it is being integrated in the sciences in multiple ways, either through content of talking about the home remedies and the histories of our contributions to science, or in understanding how students access their community cultural wealth in STEM fields and documenting some of that. And in terms of practical applications, I know that when you hear and you think about K through 16, if we're really thinking about this larger, you know, P through 20 pipeline, as they might want to call it, the practical solutions that I have is, in if I were talking to a K through 12, is start with your standards, and then if you have these content standards of what you need to accomplish, and then you make that critical, you focus it on the voices of communities of color, you engage students in creative activities that have them realize that it's not just you dumping in the knowledge, but it's also their contributions, and you make them active part of the research process, engaging them in research and having them see that they're producers of knowledge as well. And so when you think about the community college, it's in the same regard, outlining the objectives in your syllabus and making sure that you're going through all of the assignments and you're thinking about ways that you have gotten feedback from students in the past. Where are their voices centered in the readings? How have you incorporated some of the feedback that they've given you in the past? How might you offer them those nuts and bolts tools to make more transparent what you're looking for? And also just making sure that you are staying in dialogue with them. I think some of those are the practical ways. I really do think that we complicate it a lot more than it needs to be. I'll give you one last, I guess, example. I went to, like I said, I had started the Cultivating Semillas program that was very student-based and based on student volunteers. I did the Demystifying Graduate School, which was because too many students were asking me questions separately, and I wanted to kind of collect those together. And we did like a four-part series on just demystifying graduate school. And most of those students who went through the workshop series went on to graduate school. So it's identifying what your curriculum barriers are, and if it's within a particular either student services or within a class, thinking about on a week-to-week basis, whose voices am I centering in this? How is this offering some critical tools, some main critical tools that they can carry forward with them? And as I had said in the previous, to see ourselves connected across time and place is really the starting place for me. I know that when we see things in black and white, at least when my children see things in black and white, they feel like that's old history, and that has nothing to do with what they, but now we see there are contributions and ways in which we can understand the struggle for civil rights and what our classrooms looked like. That our classrooms, even in segregated spaces, which many of our students are still attending hyper-segregated schools, that those can also be places of excellence. So how might we train the next generation to be the teachers that are teachers of excellence in these places and spaces, and help our students see themselves connected across time and place, and that we are engaged in complicated but necessary and urgent recovery and reclamation process. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Yoso, for your time with us this morning. And we hope everyone else has a great great conference. And yes, take care.